I have to keep an eye on this.
Happy Merry Christmas to all my Flat Earth friends. And tonight, we have some special guests for our Flat Earth Christmas 2016. How are you guys doing tonight? I'm so excited because I have a guest coming on, and you all know her as Orphan Red. She's getting ready to come in any minute. How are you guys?
Sorry about that. There for a minute.
Okay, so where is she, Robin?
I sent her an email, so she should be there. Okay.
All right, well, what we were going to do tonight was one of the fun things we want to do is show everybody some of the traditions that we all have about Christmas. So just, you know, some of the traditions we share, memories and things that we had with our families. And in the meantime, because it is so cold, we wanted to share our favorite holiday beverage with you. And my favorite holiday beverage is eggnog. Here's my eggnog. And this is really cool eggnog because it actually goes for, let's see, each sale helps children in foster care find their home forever. So it made me feel good to have that eggnog. But with that eggnog, I have to have a little something to warm up the holiday night. So I'm going to have my eggnog here. And Robin, she has a real surprise for us. What's your favorite holiday beverage?
My favorite holiday beverage is hot chocolate with Smirnoff peppermint twist. With that Smirnoff peppermint twist in the festive Christmas bottle.
Oh, that's beautiful. That's very festive. Yeah, this has always been my drink. Eggnog with just a splash of brandy. Mm-hmm. Has that always been your drink, or is that just something new you started doing?
I've always, for a while, I've started using cocoa and peppermint vodka, so.
Oh, yeah. Well, in my drinking days, I used to drink a lot of vodka. That was one of my favorites.
It's pretty tasteless. Let me see if Sasha's still there.
Yeah, where's Sasha? Come on. We need to drink up our show.
Do you want to send her another invite? So maybe.
Okay, I will. I'll try her one more time. Or she's not in the chat?
No, she's not in the chat.
Then you can send her. You can send her the Hangouts by Google.
And I already did that.
And she can get it in the chat.
No, the link didn't work.
Huh. Maybe she's on our other show. Maybe she's somewhere. Right. Remember,
no, I just talked on chat in Facebook.
Okay. So I'm gonna put her name in.
Try another invite. See if that works.
Okay, I'm sending it to her again. Orca.
And I'll see if I can invite her the other way. Is there a link that comes up when you try to invite somebody? It's like a link in the...
Yeah.
Like, in the top of your box, there should be a link.
There is there is a link.
Try copying that link.
Okay, well, where would...
And then send it just by email to Sasha's...
I'm just going to go to my email and see it. This is a good test to see what will happen.
Yeah.
Don't worry, guys. We're going to cut this out of our Christmas show. I know how to...
Some trouble to get them if you just do the direct invite. Sometimes you have to email it to their email address directly through Outlook or something.
Do you know how to do it? You don't know what the link is. Okay, I get it. Never mind.
Yeah, you could put the link in chat, but I don't know if it'll come across directly for me.
Okay, I'm going to send it to you. It's working. Everything's still working.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Because the chat that I have at the top of my page is not the right one.
Okay. Okay, here's Orphan Red. I see her now. Okay, Orphan, I'm getting ready to send you another one. There you go. Compose.
It says here, Sasha just said, still here, having my own issues getting my mic to work with my new laptop.
Okay.
Maybe technical issues on her end, too.
Okay, so she got the invite?
Oh, let me ask her.
I don't really know how to tie it down on this thing. How did I do it before? Yeah. It's gonna take a second, Kurt.
I'm watching chat regular.
Is there anybody there?
She didn't say she didn't get the invite yet, so you're gonna have to email it to her.
Okay, I'm sending it to her right now. And I'm just gonna highlight that. Uh-oh, what the hell was that? Oh my gosh, what happened?
Just send the email first.
I know, I'm trying to get my...
Okay.
I'm trying to highlight this here. There we go.
Did you include the, she's asking, did you include the Orphan Red 6 at Gmail?
The Orphan Red what?
Orphan Red 6 at Gmail. Did you copy the link or did you get the link from where I posted it?
Yeah, I have it written. Yeah, I have it. I have it. I'm getting ready to email it to her right now. Hold on a second. I'm copying and pasting. Sorry, you guys are watching this. Give us about 15 minutes and we'll be all right. You can go do something. Get your own favorite holiday drink and everything. And come back, because it's going to be a minute. We want the show to be good. Okay, we got to have Orphan here.
Sometimes it takes a little while for the email to get to him. So
I know it. This is what I should have done before. So I think that went. The message has been sent. She should get it now. And I am going to turn this off, and I'm going to turn this off. And I wanted some Christmas music. How can we do that? Just go on and put Christmas music? Is that going to work?
iTunes. Well, I don't know. It depends on whether it's copyrighted or something.
Oh, it's just Christmas music.
Sasha said she just got it. So.
Oh, good. Okay.
Yeah, but she's still fiddling with her mic, so it might take a few minutes.
Okay. So, anyway, let's do something good. Okay. So,
first of all, after we get through, I'll send you a link to post at the bottom. There's this thing that they do in England.
Mm-hmm.
Very popular, called the Nine Lessons and Carols. We also do it at my church too, and some of the more, you know, old school churches will do the Nine Lessons and Carols. And so it's like nine scripture readings and nine Christmas carols.
Oh, that's nice. That's tradition.
The tradition that starts it usually is, let's see, I could probably use my groove music.
Sorry, sorry,
the volume.
Hold on a second. Speakers, 100%, is this what I do? Okay, I think I fixed it. Sorry, my husband was complaining I was too loud. How am I now? Talk, Robin.
You sound fine.
Okay, now you're really loud.
It was overdriving your bike before, so.
It was?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Let me know when I get loud, because it's really irritating to hear myself. Exactly. You know, I even don't like it. Okay, so. Oh, guys, so here we are. It's our Christmas party.
Okay, I'm going to send her the link because for some reason, just paste it in chat. She said, you sent me a link to compose an email.
No way. What?
Yeah, just
just send it to her. You got to just send it to her. You know,
but I don't have the link. I need you to paste the link at the top of the focus. I need you to paste the link at the top of the page into our chat, right?
You know, I finally see it. Hold on. There we go. I'm going to try to do it again.
Just paste it in there.
Okay, hold on. See?
Yeah, just let me, just copy the link and paste it in chat.
There you go. That's
okay,
it.
Okay, awesome. Copy link address. Okay, good. So, try this. I'm going to have her try this.
It's in there. She should get that. Or at least you can get it.
Yes, can you send me your link? Okay, that's what you need to send, the one that was at the top of your page.
That's what I just did. That's what that is.
That's okay. And I pasted it into the Facebook chat, so hopefully she'll hear it. And then maybe resend her the invite and see if that works, just directly, where it says you invite others.
Okay. Well, we need to have some music here. Here, I'll put it up. You know what I'll do?
Just focus on inviting her. I'll come up with some music, okay?
Okay, come up with some music.
I'll do the talking. Just
the Mormon Tabernacle Choir.
I don't have them, but I have the Cambridge Choir. Now, just focus on getting her, sending her another invite.
Okay, with her email. Get to Orphan Red.
Six. Don't forget the six.
Yeah, I got it.
Okay. Now,
the only problem that I have is sending her the link. I don't know how I'm going to give that to her. I just invited her again, but I don't know how to get that to her. That's the problem. Okay. It's not like a real invite. It's just, she just got it. There she is. There's Orphan Red coming back. There she goes. Hello. Finally.
Hi, Sasha.
It took 20 minutes, but we're all here. I know. I was running late, too.
We can see you.
I can't hear you guys.
You can't hear me?
Two people. With you.
Can you hear us?
I heard you for a minute. Just say something. Hello.
Hello, Orphan. This is a crazy party. It's going to get fun, though. It is. People, stay with us.
It's always the tech.
Get frustrated. It's going to be a great time.
It just
I'm gonna get my eggnog going in the meantime. Just look at this. Yummy. We had a very long year. A lot of things happened on the flat earth. A lot.
Yeah.
We can talk about those things.
Most of it was scandal, but other than that.
It was so funny. Just when you look back at a lot of it.
Oh, mostly I just learned to laugh at it after a while. It just got stupid.
I know. It got so, look, there's my little drink. Isn't that funny? I've never used any of these, but I don't want to drink a lot tonight, so I'm just going to give myself a little bit. That's like a little splash. What are you guys doing?
I'm telling her that we can see her, but we only heard her for a minute.
Okay, yeah. Hi. Can you hear
me? Hi, there she is.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay.
The girls are all here. The girls are all here.
Sorry, we have
technical issues on this site, so it's not your fault.
So it's on both ends today. I'm also having issues. So
yeah, really?
I have a new laptop just as a replacement because my laptop is broken and they're trying to fix it. So they gave me this new machine that it's all starting from scratch. So
What are the Christmas spirits you're imbibing there?
Oh, I have mixed, this is my own concoction, Bailey's with peppermint vodka and a little bit of cream.
Oh, that sounds good.
What are you guys drinking?
Peppermint vodka is a very popular one.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, she has peppermint vodka too.
In hot chocolate.
Okay, very nice.
I just have eggnog with a splash of brandy, which I do every year, because I'm not really a drinker, so
okay.
I can't really taste it that much.
Okay.
It's good.
Yum. I'm going to move things around so I can see chat in case there's anyone in chat.
I'm eyeballing chat, too. So.
Okay.
I'm going to try and do it. What if I do that? Will it mess up everything?
Yes.
Yeah, well, I know. I'm never supposed to see chat.
It took us a half hour to get you to look at it once, and it disappeared. So
I know. At one time, I'm like, "That's where I'm supposed to be," and Robin's like, "Don't look, cause you can't do it." I'm like, "Oh my gosh, help me!"
Because if you look, looking at the wrong one, it'll throw you off. You have to kind of set it up so you can see both. You know.
I know. I'm gonna have to come to Washington, and you can show me how to do it in person.
Yeah.
You know, this is what I would really recommend, though. When you're done and the video is uploaded and all done, go in and trim the beginning. And I wish more people would do this, like Jed and Del.
I get it the first time on my last one because one of my stops goes, you need to cut that out. So I get it. I'm like, thanks for telling me that. I'm going to do that because nobody wants to see that craft.
No.
You know, I mean, nobody wants to see that. But we're here now, right, girls?
Yay.
I'm so happy to talk enough to Orphan Red, Sasha. I've been watching you for the longest time, and I'm just a big fan.
I'm so pleased. Thank you.
I love it.
But I just I'm really glad to see you because, you know, I've met you in person before and I haven't seen you since then.
But
just want everybody to know that Sasha's a wonderful person. She was at the mixer and we all had a great time and she was taking pictures of everyone and she's just the nicest person you'd ever want to meet. She's just what you see there is
different.
Thank you, Rob. And that means a lot, actually. Coming from you, that means a lot.
I've just seen a lot of snotty comments on some of your videos. And I know you put up with it. And people totally misjudge you. And it's just not right. And I'll have to, like I say, I've met her in person. I've shaked her hand. And I know she's an awesome person.
You know, I think people really like when they can put others in easy boxes. And I think that there are some of us like you and like me, and I just think we don't fit into those easy boxes, but people just really want us to.
I know, huh?
So I think it makes them angry when you don't fit into a box. So they feel deceived or they feel like, oh, something's wrong because you're not fitting into my box.
I know. I totally agree.
They're blowing away their reality. They can't handle it. That's what
I'm looking at. Yes.
So, I mean, we're just different. I mean, just being a flat earther in itself is different. We see something that other people don't, period. And it really trips me out when people are always like, are they faking it? They can't possibly believe the earth is flat. And I'm like, no, I'm not faking it.
I am a terrible liar and a terrible actor. So, you know, what you see is what you get. And if the thing is when I try to tell them the earth is flat and they argue with me and then I break out the math and the geometry and geography and they get all their eyes start glazing over because that's my problem is I want to go to the equations and stuff.
Yeah, exactly. That's too much for some people.
Yeah, I think for most people actually. And I'm not sure that it's convincing because I think even if you show the math to people who understand it, there's still something that just they just refuse to buy into it. They refuse to accept it. And I remember reading a few years ago that it's really not facts that persuade people. People think it's facts and they try to use facts, especially for political persuasion. Mm-hmm. But it's people aren't persuaded by facts. They're persuaded by emotion.
Exactly. And so, the way they make you feel.
Yeah, so you just have to appeal to people's emotion.
I'm sorry, go ahead. We're all talking at once. Go ahead.
When people get all emotional about something, I say, somebody's being manipulated here, and I hope it's not me.
That's a good one.
Because, you know, the thing that really persuaded me, and, you know, a lot of people make fun of him or say he's like a shill or something, but Mark Sargent's Flat Earth Clues, he lays it out in an orderly manner. And I like that orderliness of his, the clues. I think it's a very good persuader.
I think so.
That's just me. And he doesn't have any strong emotion when he's exposing this stuff. He just, here it is. You know,
yeah,
and he says,
somewhere between Dubé and, he's like Dubé and who? And somebody like
that. That was got me going because he says, but don't listen to me. Ask questions and do your own research. And that's exactly what I did. I went out and verified what he was explaining in his video. So, yeah. So I don't know. To me, emotion doesn't appeal to me, but maybe a lot of people it does, you know.
Robin, that's why I have you on my show. People always say, why do you have Robin? Because she's the opposite of me. I'm emotional. I just go for that emotion because that's why I feel that, you know, really are when you get really emotional about stuff. And she's like Spock. She's like having Spock in the Enterprise. Like she knows everything. She knows all these languages. She knows the whole Bible back and forth. she's wonderful like that, where I don't have time for all that. I want to know how you feel. I'm a drug counselor. I want to know what's going on. What caused this? Let's go back and talk about your child.
I'm like Spock and she's like Dr. McCoy.
Oh, is that what it is?
And he's always, damn it, Jim.
Damn it.
I'm a doctor, not a bricklayer.
So yeah, and let's back to that subject on how people just don't get us, huh? People just don't get us, and I'm really getting frustrated. I'll tell you what, I'm really getting frustrated after this year. Let's talk about the year. I'm getting frustrated with the people who are turncoats, and I just have to say this. I don't really appreciate that much the people that, you know, they hang around the flat earthers. They're trolling us to death, and yet they don't believe anything. And they'll turn on you in a minute and go, I know. And I'm like, oh, my God, are you serious? You're like a traitor.
Yeah, well, the ones that, like, turn on you that are obvious trolls, my approach to them is delete the comments, block them, ignore, and report.
That's what I do, too. I love to report them. I don't even know if they know that they've been reported. Do they know?
But who specifically, like, because I think that there are different kinds of people that are on the fringes of the flat earth, that they want to be involved in the community and they want to participate, but they're not flat earthers. And I think some of them are just destroying everything because we can't, all we're doing is arguing with them and they're just distracting us. So we can't actually do what we should be doing instead. But some of them, I think, do offer a valuable service. And I think what they do is they prevent nonsense from getting entrenched, because sometimes I think there's a little bit of nonsense that pours into the Flat Earth community. And you do need people who are going to say, look, this is nonsense. And I think when Flat Earthers try to say it, oh, we get in trouble. And yeah. So I think it's okay to have kind of those people in the fringes.
Constructive commentary, you know. He's like, you know, Jed Skeptic, he says he's not a flat earther, but he does provide a sort of third opinion or so, you know, with in a different way. And so mostly I appreciate his comments, but some of these people, like the zillions of Tim Osman clones, you know, and all that.
Yeah. I think Tim Osman got me again the other day, and I'm like, God damn it, that was him.
Blocked.
I can tell by the way it was written, and I go, he got me again.
What do you mean, got you? What do you mean, got you? What did he do?
Oh, he's. I'm sure it was him because the way it was written, and it was something like, what is it about flat Earth that draws all these psychopaths and whatever? And like, I answered his question, like.
See, I would have been smiling
at you. I answered his question. They're not all, you know, it doesn't draw.
My answer. What I would have answered is, so are you telling me you're a psychopath?
I know, that's what I should have said. But I was just being, you know.
I mostly just block, deny, delete, and report. Yeah. And ignore.
And ignore.
Just don't even, you have something, Sasha?
Well, like, I think that there is value in looking at who is drawn to the idea of the flat earth, and are they drawn to it because they just want to be subversive and they're just looking to rebel against the system, and this is a way of doing it. If that's the case, it's okay to know that, because how to serve that portion of the community is going to be different than how we serve the portion of the community who want facts and information and are in this because they really believe that the earth can't be a globe. And so I think it's okay to kind of figure out, but what they're doing is a negative thing. They're saying only crazy people are interested in this. Therefore, mm-hmm. if you're interested in this, you're crazy. So if you don't want people thinking you're crazy, then stay away from this. And I think that's where that agenda of ridiculing something so that everyone's afraid to be involved. That makes me so angry, because they pretend that they're interested in truth.
I know.
But if they really were, they would encourage people to ask questions, even if the question seems to you ridiculous. Yeah. You should encourage people to ask it of themselves and of those around them, right? So they're not actual truth seekers. Like Tim Osmond and the people that were on Dell's show the other day, and even John LeBon, I kind of go back and forth. I don't know whether I trust him or not. And that's part of it is sometimes I think he's helping us figure out more about our community and who's here and why we're here. And sometimes I think he has this agenda of he wants to expose the truth that the flat earth is damaged, broken people and that are coming together and in some way kind of making their damage worse. And they're just needy cult following people.
I don't understand. It's a very positive idea. I think people try to co-opt it because it, to build their own little power base. Because you see that with Bay, you see that to some degree with other people. I just think that that's something, I see it a lot among these very fringe Christians, the Hebrew roots types, who have kind of got into flat earth to kind of co-opt it and get everybody into their belief system or whatever, which, you know, I mean, it's like, fine, you say that this proves that everybody should belong to whatever you believe, but
A little bit more. When we start talking about religion, I need a drink here.
But I just think, you know, all the other Christian churches, they all believe that, you know, the world is created by God and there was a firmament and all that. So why does that make your religion so special?
Well, here's what I think. You know what? Before flat earth came around, people could all agree on something without having religion in it. Now flat earth comes around. Now everybody wants to make it be a religion or make it be a cult.
Yeah,
one has nothing to do with the other.
It's not just even Christian. It's like New Agers. They're trying to overlay their spiritual beliefs over it.
Exactly. It's mostly, I think, even more than the Christians.
Yeah.
I think it's the New Agers and this whole new thing with the urine. And we were talking about the Satanism lately and all that kind of stuff and how they're always interested in bodily fluids of all different kinds. You kind of see a little bit of a link there. And, you know, between these new the urine and the Satanist ways of doing things.
Because it's Christmas and there's a lot of people out there in these alternative Christian groups, like the Hebrew roots and all that, who think all these holidays that Christians celebrate, Easter and Christmas, and all of these things are evil and they're satanic. And it's like they try to find the satanic in everything. You know, maybe they're just people having fun.
Orphan Red, I know that you said you're not religious or anything like that, but just to get your opinion, can you put an opinion on things like, you know, we know you're not all religious and stuff, and we don't want to talk about religion the whole time. So
no, I just point out that there's a lot of people who are opposed to Christmas, you know.
There are more and more people, that's for sure. There are more and more people saying that it's an old pagan holiday and it was. What's your opinion about Orphan?
Well, so I'm not a Christian, and I try to be open about that. I've said it before in shows, but when people find out, they do tend to get annoyed, and I keep saying, well, I've already said it in multiple shows. But I celebrate Christmas because to me, it's about generosity, and it's about empathy. And you know, when you give a gift, it's that when you give the right gift, that perfect gift, and the person that you love opens it, and they immediately know that you understand them because you got them something that shows that you know them well enough to know what they like. Not an iPhone or something stupid like that, but something that really shows, like, I know you, I get you.
Yeah.
That is what I think is that fulfilling sense of empathy and that joy of recognizing that, yeah, I actually took time to figure out what you'd like and I found it.
Yeah.
I really like that. And I think it's a ritual. And human beings, we do enjoy ritual and we need ritual. When you take away rituals from human beings, societies, we then typically switch to routines. So we create these routines to replace ritual. But because they don't have that meaning and purpose that we get from rituals, what happens is you end up with anxiety, OCD, because you have that routine, but because it's not giving you that sense of purpose, something feels wrong. And I think that explains a lot about what's going wrong in secular societies. And I think it could be fixed by attaching meaning and purpose to rituals without having to necessarily attach them to a specific religion. So for me, Christmas is a time of love, coming together with people that you love and celebrating that you love each other and singing songs. Again, when you sing in groups, it promotes happiness and it promotes bonding and that promotes intimacy. So,
and it also promotes culture because, you know, there's different, these rituals promote a kind of even artistic culture. You know?
Exactly. Yeah, it does. It really does. It's a fabric that brings human beings together, and we need to have that. It's just like when they're training dogs. Dogs are not good when they're not trained. They're not happy. They like to be trained. They like to know that you're the master and they're your doggy and you're training them and you love them, and they want to be trained. They're not happy in just letting your dog just run around willy-nilly. That's when they start getting into aberrant behavior and tearing your shoes up and biting shoes and getting angry.
I remember a quote by Carl Jung, the famous psychologist.
With Freud.
Yeah, he was like kind of thinking differently than Freud, but you know, he was more into archetypes and stuff.
Yeah.
He said that I thought was really profound was that ritual speaks to your subconscious. In other words, there's a greater depth of understanding about something when it's in a ritual.
Exactly. Yeah. There's something about that ritual that just it calms us down and makes us feel like Orphan was saying, we have purpose. We are working towards something. It also lets us know another year has gone by. Here's another Christmas.
Robin, I think your comment about it being a unifying culture, it's a unifying cultural practice that we all participate in regardless of our beliefs, I think that's really true. And especially now when there's such a push towards this diversity where we're not actually allowed to have these group activities.
Identity. You know.
And I think it's damaging. I think that Christmas as a culture is a good thing. Like in Canada, we still wish each other Merry Christmas in most places, even if we may not know what religion the other person is, because Christmas is now a Canadian celebration rather than a Christian celebration. I think that's okay because the intent is really good.
Exactly. I agree. And that's the thing. I don't look at Christmas as some kind of pagan holiday when the real truth is that it was some god, you know, this is Odin and he did all these horrible things. But that's not me.
Yeah.
This is how I see it. That's Odin. And you know, these like bizarre pagan things that they're doing. That's not me in my house. We had a wonderful time at Christmas. Odin wasn't there. Right? He wasn't.
No,
he really wasn't.
No sacrificing.
There was no sacrifice with Odin on the. That wasn't the 25th. It was the 29th.
Yeah,
it was important. It doesn't matter. People, please, really, Odin's not here.
I wanted to bring up one of the things that, you know, people talk about the Christmas tree. You get a lot of these people saying, the radical, fringy Christians say, you're bowing down before this tree and worshiping a tree. And
I know. Everything's worshiping something.
I just thought I'd bring up the story of how the Christmas tree came about. Okay? How it became. Yeah. So anyway, there was this guy. His name is Saint Boniface. He was in the medieval times. Let's see, when was he? 723, about. The early 700s in medieval times.
Okay.
He was a Benedictine missionary in Germany. He was from England, and he was taking the Christianity to the German tribes, the Germania of ancient times. And one of the things they said was they had a tree called in Geismar, the village of Geismar, was a huge old oak tree known as the Thunder Oak. It was dedicated to the god Thor, and they actually sacrificed human beings. They're usually a small child to the pagan god.
That's terrible.
Yeah, I know. That's why he, and so Boniface, Boniface wanted to prove that this tree wasn't holy. So he took a big axe and with some of his friends, and even though the Germans threatened they would kill him if he cut down this tree, that thunder oak. And he took a big axe and chopped at it. And they say it was, in the old stories, they say it was a miracle because he took this giant oak down with one stroke of the axe.
Oh, so well, I know.
That might not be completely true, right?
Not 100%.
Yeah. So anyway, he cut down the tree, and then as the branches parted, as the tree fell down, there was a little fir tree in the middle of it.
Huh.
And so they were astonished that, you know, this little fir tree would survive having the oak crash on top of it, right?
Uh-huh.
So the Saint Boniface pointed to the tree and he said, "This little tree, a young child of the forest, shall be your holy tree tonight. It is the wood of peace. It is a sign of an endless life, for its leaves are evergreen. See how it points upward to heaven. Let this be called the tree of the Christ child. Gather about it, not in the wild wood, but in your own homes, where it will shelter no deeds of blood, but loving gifts and rites of kindness." So that's the story of where the Christmas tree came.
And yeah.
So the German peoples took a little tree into their house at Christmas time, decorated it to remind them to be peaceful, think of God, and be kind and loving to each other.
Okay, and now we make such a big deal over it. So yeah, I think what we need to do ultimately is we need to get our mind out of the past, I think.
Yeah.
I think some people are still fighting the Reformation. Some people are still in the Crusades. Some people are still, you know, way back in like 300. Well, really, we are in 2016.
And they need to bear in mind that the Christmas tree was not actually a part of the Christmas celebration in other countries until it was brought to England initially in the mid-1800s.
Whoa, is anybody, wait a second, I need another drink. Nobody's having any drink?
Yes, we are.
Yeah, we are.
I've been pouring it under the eye line here. So.
I know. Huh? For 2016, we'll do a cheer in a minute. But that's, yeah, I love this conversation. We're really
peppermint. But that's where the tree. I mean, some of these things come from totally. There's no evil pagan satanic undertones to this. It's all just part of the whole spirit of Christmas. The spirit, you know, in our bottle here. But time to be jolly with your friends and family and celebrate the birth of Christ, and you know, that was,
and give each other gifts to show how much I, like Sasha was saying, we like to give each other gifts because we want to show we love other people and we know them and we look at something they want, we care enough.
Do you ever do that?
I think one of the things that I see, because I do see a lot of this on Facebook, a lot of people that are saying, like, this is evil, so don't do this, or, like, Christmas is evil, Lucifer. Yes. And I think signs and symbols can be imbued with intent, and then they have power because you believe in them. And again, they're really just tokens of a ritual, and it's not the token that has power, and it's really not even the ritual. The ritual allows you to build intent and build intensity and increase your belief. And we know from physics experiments that the observer effect is a thing, and that when you have sexually bonded couples, they have a stronger effect on quantum particles. And so we already have this idea that when people are bonded, their effects are stronger. And I think when you believe, then you're fervently focused, because it takes focused awareness. It's not just distracted awareness that has an impact on quantum particles. It's focused awareness. And so the ritual focuses the awareness. So if someone tells you this is an evil token, this is an evil Christmas tree, and by having it in your house, you can call on Lucifer and he'll come and show up, then you can probably do that. But if you instead see the Christmas tree as a source of light and joy, and it's a center around the love or whatever, then that's what you're focusing your
life on. I agree 100% with that. Absolutely.
It's so,
I think people are just afraid. People are afraid because they don't know why things are wrong or evil, and they don't know why things are bad, and they're just looking for an explanation that makes sense. And there is one, but instead of looking at that one, which is maybe more complicated, they want an easy one. They want, like, the Christmas tree is evil. Well, no, it's what you're intending and focus. So I think that's part of the problem. Again, I kind of keep coming up against this in the Flat Earth, where I see there's a really big desire for simplification, and I think that that harms us more than it helps us.
Don't you, Robin? If you oversimplify, you're going to close off your mind to other possibilities that could be there, and you won't learn this much.
Absolutely, absolutely. But the bottom line is that it is what you make it, and if you just want to see all this, I mean, you're going to drive yourself crazy. I'm just going to tell you that. Because there's every single thing you do can be attributed to some demon or something. I mean, I saw this old almanac from like somewhere in the South or something. And it was like, if you're walking down the street and a crow passes you on a Sunday and it passes you from the right, that means somebody's going to die. But if the crow comes at noon and passes you from the left on a Sunday, that means you're getting married. I mean, it was just all this innocuous stuff. And you're just going, I mean, you're just going to make yourself crazy to get to that point. And how birds fly around you now. I mean, where are we going to
become an obsessive, compulsion of some kind.
Isn't it, huh? Yeah, at that point, you are treading on that kind of water.
I know, because the people that are most superstitious people I've ever met are goalies in a hockey game. They're so obsessive. I mean, it's like where the salt is placed on the tables, how well they're going to do in the game. I mean, you ever go to a hockey game?
But science is doing the same thing right now. This is why my whole thing, I'm fighting scientism, because I see that scientists also are struggling to understand, and so they're trying to hold on to things that make it more accessible to them, right? So the idea of the cosmos and stars being billions of light years away, they have this whole narrative, and that's why they don't want to question it. And I think that's why Flat Earth is so threatening to the mainstream, because it's a security blanket.
Yeah, yeah. The globe is their friend, you know.
it really is the religion of the non-religious.
Yes.
Scientism, right? I mean.
Oh, but speaking of traditions, like before we started, Lisa asked me to find a Christmas song, and I was telling her about the 9 lessons and carols. I don't know if you do that up there in the Great White North, but. But a lot of churches do that, where they have just the 9 lessons of carols. It's just fun. It's nice. They have a little reading. And then they sing a song, you know. And I was telling her, like, the first – I just wanted to, you know, talk about that, because it's kind of a happy little thing that they do with Christmas, is the 9
– Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And I just want to say, because this one's the really cutest one, is the first one. They always sing this. It's like tradition. Yeah, again, tradition. Here we are. And what is wrong with tradition? There's nothing wrong with tradition. And one of the things they sing is so beautiful, and it's so cute, because they take the youngest member, like on these boys' choirs, the youngest member that can sing, right, starts the song. It's always tradition. It's the youngest member of the choir, and these little boy choirs. And it's called Once in Royal David City, and she wanted me to come up with some music. You said so, Lisa, right?
I did.
So I got this on my computer. It's
Oh, yay.
It's, I think this is it. Yeah, okay. I think this is the right one.
This eggnog couldn't be any better.
Oh, yeah. Mm. Here we go. I think it'll work. If it's the wrong one, I apologize.
Yummy.
Oh wait, that's not the one. I have one here. They're trying to sell me a song here, so I need to find in my library. Oh, here it is. I just clicked the wrong one. Okay, here goes. Okay. You should be able. You should. Starts out soft. Can you hear it at all? I need to move it way up.
You know what? Maybe Lisa could add it in.
Huh?
Maybe Lisa could add it in after, just the audio.
Oh, yeah, I could do that. We could do that.
You can find it on Facebook, too. It's pretty big, easy to find.
Yeah, next time I'm going to have all this is going to be like state of the art. And, you know, I'm going to have the, because I wanted to play my favorite song, which is the Mormon Tabernacle Choir, when they do the bells, the sound of the bells, the carol of the bell. So every year I put that on Facebook, and I love it. And I'm not Mormon or anything, and I'm not like whatever. I'm not Mormon, but it's so beautiful.
I don't know.
Amazing. So many people in this Mormon Tabernacle Choir, and they're up in this big tree. Have you ever seen that? There's hundreds of people in the tree.
Yeah, I've seen.
And they're singing all together, and it is just, it's just what I do when I feel that spirit about this time, about the 17th, about a week before, and I play that, and it just, yay, wonderful.
Just a second, let me see if you can hear this. I'll try one more time, and then I'll end.
Okay, we'll try. I can't. There we go. Turn a little bit louder.
That's about as good as I can get.
Aw. It's nice, though.
It's one little boy singing. Cut him a break.
Aw. Aw.
I'm going to listen while I refresh my drink.
I know, huh? Yeah, I'll be back, too. I'm going to listen while I get a little ice cube. Hold on. You're all by yourself. Be right back. That's just precious. Hold on.
Okay, I can't play too much of it because I'll probably get a copyright strike there, but.
You know what? They don't seem to be that tough on people. I haven't had any problem, but I don't have anything that I put on that.
I will give them full attribution. This is the King's College Choir in Cambridge, England. They're the best.
Oh, it's beautiful. It really is. And these poor little boys, I hope that one was treated good.
They're very famous.
You never know. Now you hear anything, you think there's a whole conspiracy there. Everybody's touched. Unfortunately, there's a lot of that, but
yeah,
you know.
Oh, wait, I'll send you the link afterwards. It's really beautiful. They carry all the boys' choirs carry little candles down the aisle. It's really lovely.
Amazing. Yeah, I mean, I don't know what the point is just to not have any tradition and to make your own up and just be. Don't look at anything in the past and like things that are. I like things that are old and traditional. That's me. That's all me. That's what I like. I like old houses. I like engravings on all the buildings. They're really intricate and beautiful.
The best Christmas music I've ever heard was this choir, the King's College Choir at Cambridge, England. It's like a male and boys choir together.
What about the Mormon Tabernacle Choir?
I'll find one. Most of theirs are kind of cheesy, though, so I'll try to find one of theirs. You know, I know you like Mormon.
Put Carol of the Bells on, please.
You know what? You're going to get your video torn down for copyright if you use that, though.
Yeah.
So, 2016, Christmas time, what are you kind of planning for the transition to 2017?
New Year's Eve is going to be great. I actually like New Year's Eve sometimes more than Christmas.
Oh.
Yeah, I think it's kind of, you know, it's, well, if you're a single person, New Year's Eve is more your thing, you know. But, you know, I think 2017, for one thing, I got a new job. That's happy, you know.
Congratulations.
And I work for the Federal Aviation Agency.
What?
And the office group right next to me is the aerospace group.
Oh, wow.
So are you going to be leaking us secrets?
No, but I don't know. I'd like to write a letter to Trump and say, you want to cut costs, just get rid of NASA.
I know.
You should. You should.
I think
stand
he knows
up.
That, though.
I don't know.
You want to save like $12 billion a year? Just cancel NASA.
I know. What idiots they are.
Or I could suggest that they subcontract it to Pixar.
Okay, but what about this? So, because we don't know if it's the dome enclosed world or if it's the infinite plane. I don't like the word infinite because it implies actually infinite, whereas I think vast plane, because we don't actually know what the boundaries might be. But so if it's not the dome, if it's the vast plane, so what if they're actually out exploring neighboring petals, and that's what they're doing when they say they're going to Mars? I don't know.
I don't think they're doing anything.
They're showing balls in space with no stars behind them and stuff like that, you know, I mean.
Well, yeah, they're showing all that nonsense, but like the rovers that they're training in northern Canada.
Yeah.
I was gonna try to make an argument for like somehow maybe that they're sending them through Antarctica over to other places, but it's a weak argument.
No, let me tell you, talking about people that you know, my husband's sister is actually dating a man who actually claims, and I believe he works for some kind of like JPL type thing, where he tells us that he's working on the Mars rover. Now, he really is that could be working on a rover, so I'm not going to say a word to him. But I don't believe it's going into Mars, because I don't believe there is a Mars, and I don't believe there ever will be any Mars that we can actually go on. But he sure thinks that's what he's doing.
I hate to quote my friend Mark Sargent again, but there's this thing in government research called compartmentalization.
Woo! Feeling good.
They just give you a little piece of the project, and you don't know what the other people are doing. So that's how they keep it, you know, under wraps.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, but I think that there, I just stumbled across, and I posted it on Facebook too, is this video. It was kind of grainy, but basically what it was it was a video produced in Russian, had English subtitles on it. So it came out of the Russian government. And they were talking about Admiral Byrd's expedition.
Really?
To Antarctica. And I mean, I know that the seas are kind of choppy and they have bad windstorms and stuff, but they lost a lot of ships, right? And when they went down, this is Operation High Jump, where they went down and they had a lot of ships.
I'll be right back.
And on, you know, it was a huge military. It wasn't like an exploration. It was a military. It was a military project. It was a military
operation.
Operation. I don't know why my brain went. I had too much.
It's the vodka.
Vodka, right?
It tastes so nice, though. It's lovely.
No, it goes down so easy. But anyway, let me just check here. Oh, anyway,
I forgot my cat.
But one of the things that, oh, you're naughty. But what I found was interesting.
Oh, what? It says naughty on one side and nice on the other.
Oh, you put naughty up. That was subconscious. You
know? Oh, my God. I thought it was, this was the nice one, right?
No, just subconscious. Nice,
you can change your mind after a few drinks. I think I'll be naughty.
Yeah, I think we're prompted by your subconscious
No, not everything's a subconscious now.
But anyway, the thing I found interesting about this is they were not so masked. I mean, they were talking about a lot of stuff that didn't come out from the U.S. The U.S. tried to cover too much of it up. And what they said was that when the U.S. forces went down to McMurdo, to Little America, you know, south of Australia there, that they, the aircraft carriers, they had like three aircraft carriers. Two of them were destroyed, supposedly by bad storms, around Antarctica. And this Russian video had photographs of where they were actually fired on by advanced aircraft with advanced weapons, like, you know, energy weapons.
Really?
Yeah, and there may have been another reason why Admiral Byrd cut off all exploration of Antarctica, and another reason why they declared it off limits.
And what's your theory? Sorry, I was going to say to Robin, what's your theory?
I know, I'm wondering why.
I don't know. This is some new information I just stumbled across. And, I mean, there have been some people who say that while the Germans were down there, they were able to find advanced weapons. I don't know if it was the Germans who built advanced weapons down there. I don't think they would have had enough time to set up a huge factory complex to do this. I think they found something that was already there. And they may have done it, or maybe these people didn't want either the U.S. or the Germans down there. And the Germans, that was near Neuschwabia, south of Africa. If you go south from Africa, you hit Neuschwabia, which was where the Germans were. And they said they found tunnels through the ice, in other words, places where the ice had melted, and there were these big tunnels going back through the ice further into the interior. And they were setting up all kinds of boats and stuff to go down these tunnels. And it's possible they might have found something.
I don't know. Maybe whatever it was had to be monumental to result in, you know, all the countries of the world just standing back and not wanting to go and look anymore in that area for anything. It's just strange. It's just weird.
The thing that was most unusual about it is it was following not just an exploration where you go down with some boats and planes and try to go further and further into the interior. It was a major military operation. So people were armed for bear to go down there and do something. there wasn't a lot. And then the fact that they closed it off immediately, and it wasn't for some, as they portray now, it's like some environmental reason. I mean, as Mark Sargent says, you know, this is the time of, you know, 20-cent gas and hot dogs and burgers, you know.
I know. Speaking of that,
I think they ran into something advanced down there and they didn't want to deal with it, and they're trying to protect the world from whatever's down there and keep us out of it.
No, I don't believe it. I'm sorry. I don't see them as protecting any world. They are only protecting themselves. That's the kind of people they are. I don't think they give a damn about protecting the world.
It's possible they may have cut a deal with these people saying, if you let us come down here, we won't let any of these other people come down here.
No, they would have to have. I don't know. I don't think he found anything. My theory is nothing happened. I think it was just, because I don't believe that. I don't know. I can't say nothing happened, because obviously there is a treaty with the United Nations to not. So something happened. I have no idea. It's one of those things where you just have to say, what the heck? I don't know. We'll ever know.
Yeah, there is like, remember that map that they found that they published in the Hawaiian newspaper that showed there were other worlds outside of this one. Now, I don't know how valid that is, but
or other continents.
Other continents on the other side of the ice wall. And they say, that according to them, it's like another sun and another moon that kind of...
I've heard that one. I don't know. The reason why I say it can't be much, because I think we're coming to the point where, you know, these people that are in power are so thrilled with themselves right now. Well, that it's almost like Cooper's delight, like with all the stuff that's been going on. They can't even help but say, let this stuff flow, like the pizza gate thing. They're letting this stuff out because they're so freaking proud of their evil.
Well, the thing is, there have been a lot of people have recently, and I mean in the past 3 or 4 months, like during this all this election stuff, there have been people from the party in power right now who have gone down to Antarctica in several, like John Kerry, and there was a couple other people. Like
the Pope's went there, all that. Leave people going there.
Yeah. The head of that was the Archpatriarch of Moscow went down there. Now that for some other reason that had everybody scared. It's like for some reason people go down there either because they're scared about something that they need to take care of down there, or they're scared about something that's down there.
Right? Yeah, there's something there.
There's something fearful in Antarctica.
I don't know. What do you think, Sasha?
Well, we can only kind of make guesses based on the information that we have, and we have very little information. And I worry a little bit about speculating too much.
Yeah.
I think that to say that nothing is going on down there would be naive, because like Robin said, the Russian Orthodox Church, the head of the Russian Orthodox Church was down there. Kerry was down there. So there does seem to be something that's drawing these leaders, which tells me that there's something. At the same time, they're not staying there, so they're actually going back home afterwards. And politically, nothing's changing. So it seems to me that whatever it is, they have no control over it. They have no say. They have no power or influence. If it is something else preventing them from going further into Antarctica, then whatever it is that they're trying to negotiate with, it seems to me the negotiations have failed. And
that's a good way to say it. I agree. Something's not working out real great.
And one of the things I have problems with, and I'm not picking on him because I personally dislike him, it's just because it's the most recent example that comes to mind, Antonio's new map.
Oh, yeah.
Now, in the past, you wouldn't have YouTube, you wouldn't have this forum where people can disagree and say, this is why this is wrong, or this is why this person is less trustworthy, or maybe not a good person, or maybe looking to exploit you or make money off of you, whatever, right? But in the past, if they didn't have that, then I could see people, because we see it in the flat earth. We see the people that are just looking for someone to follow. And I'm not saying that's everyone in the flat earth, but we see it in any community. There is a subset of people who just want a guru, a leader. They just tell me what to believe and I will follow you, right? And I think I see better how it works because of my experience with the flat earth. The pee drinking, disgusting things that were going on with the potato crew gang, whatever you want to call them, and they were really trying to say to their followers, like, this will heal you. Some people were buying into that. The potato people themselves didn't buy into it, but they were giving it to their followers, and some of their followers were like, okay, I'm going to try this. And I got emails from people saying, oh, look, I am healed. And I thought, well, yeah, of course, the placebo effect and the Messiah effect. But so I guess my point is that, for example, the map of the other continents, we can take it as, oh, these people knew something and maybe they did. But on the other hand, it might just have been some guy like Antonio, some artist saying, this is the map of these other continents. Like, give me your money and I will lead you there on an expedition. Or do you know what I mean? Like, it could just have been a bunch of guys like Matt Farrell and Antonio getting together and creating this map and getting people to fund their little adventure, but it doesn't mean that it's real. And I think we have to be careful about that.
You know what's scary to me? I have this thought every once in a while that, why is it that we all know for sure? Like, I know for sure the earth is flat. I've known it all my life, I think. I never believed any of this. Never once. I remember watching the Discovery Channel and they going, okay, here's what it is. All the stars that you see, they're really not there. Imagine. They're not there. Look, they're not there. They were there 100 million billion years ago. Trust me. but you're not actually seeing the star. You're actually seeing a reflection of a star that's been, is now dead. And I remember as a teenager going, what horse crap is that?
Well, for me,
it's ridiculous.
That the hook for me with Flat Earth, I didn't believe it. I was a NASA fangirl. I was sci-fi and all that, you know. But what did it for me was water. You can't see a curve on the water. It, you know, and I live in the Puget Sound area or near the ocean. I can go out and look at these things and say, I can see with my own eyes. I can make the calculations. And, you know, it has nothing to do with how I feel about it. It's just there. You can't get away from it. So.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, what about you, Orphan? Do you feel like you have been, you kind of always knew this, or this is something that you just, how did it affect you?
No, I looked into it. I really researched it, and I really tried to take it down to things that, because I was really, I was a scienter. I was a devout follower of scientism. And so
yeah,
I really had to take it apart, and I mean, there were things that were troubling me beforehand. Gravity, they couldn't find gravitons. Gravity is not it's not an explanation. It's just a description of something that happens, but it doesn't tell you why it happens. And they pretend that by calling it the theory of gravity, it explains gravity. No, you still haven't told me why these things are happening. You just keep telling me that they are happening, that the name of the fact that it happens is gravity. And so I had problems like that, I guess more logical issues. And when I was doing statistics, I realized how much of science is a sham and how many academics are lying to people, taking taxpayer money grants and just lying to get published. And that kind of opened me up to the idea that this is a huge phenomenon where scientists are just lying to people.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's sad, really.
Yeah,
it's really just ridiculous stuff. But here's the thing. Remember when I told you that something keeps coming in my mind? It's coming there again. What if you believe in reincarnation and I go back and forth on it, what if Antonio was like one of these old artists fighting in the Reformation, drawing, you know? What if Matt Bauerlin was actually like one of these guys that said, I'll get me 100 ships and I'm going to go down there. I'll bring you back a map. What if we're all somebody that literally lived in the times when Flat Earth was like happening? And that's why we're seeing it again. And our minds, like our ears are peeking up and going, what? And you know, we're all coming out of the, you know.
We're getting a lot of comments. You want me to go through some of
them? Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Say you better be being good, because he knows, for goodness sake.
Okay, so
bad trolls out there.
Jay Dreamers says he thinks they found a door or entrance to another realm. And let's see what else.
I think that's an interesting theory.
Yeah, there's something. Maybe they have some contact, something like that, right? Where they can go and talk to, pray to, whatever, something.
Yeah. Maybe something there was weird. A door. The Germans seem to think there was some kind of door into another realm where they were at. But let's see. Let me see who else is out here. Does J.S. Mario says, Operation Fishbowl makes me think they found the enclosure, the boundary, the edge, and the dome. And that
me
would,
too.
That would make sense to me that there was, they were.
That
they
would make sense to me. It would. So we have three. It would make sense now. That, yeah. I can see them coming to the edge and there's nothing to it.
I keep thinking, I don't know if this is the vodka speaking, the peppermint vodka, but I keep seeing this coming up in different sources, in different places, and I keep kind of this idea that, okay, so for one, again, I'm undecided, I'm on the fence between dome and vast plane, but here's the thing with the dome. It seems to me that there are a lot of, and biblical passages, but not just in the Bible, in other kind of religious texts and other myths, this idea that there are gates that between our world and
yeah.
something else, but that they're timed gates, that the gates open on a specific schedule. And this is why you have all this obsessive tracking of the sun and the moon and the stars. And I think that that's what's, I don't know, I just, maybe it's not that I believe, but I'm fascinated and I'm entertained by the fantasy, the story that there are gates and that you have to know when to access Ooh. Them because they only open in these particular moments. And those moments, you can know when they're occurring based on what we see in the sky. And I don't believe that it's true, but it's like a sci-fi story that I enjoy.
And I come from a big sci-fi, and I know, that's awesome. I come from loving sci-fi too, just like you. I have all the posters of Star Wars. I collected original movie posters for a long time. I have all the Star Wars, all the Star Trek, all of them. Well, I mean, I love the idea of Star Wars and all that, so really.
I think you might be onto something with these gates being timed, because if you actually look in the book of Enoch, it talks about the sun and the moon moving through gates.
Yeah.
Like a big
pearl gate.
Like the big clock. Okay. Yeah. Or there was like several portals or gates that, and also you see this in the old, the icons in Russia and Greek. Greek and Russian icons, you'll see this kind of oval-shaped window surrounding certain saints or angels. And according to what I've, because I studied iconography, and one of the things that the instructor, she was really brilliant. She had a PhD in theology and art. So she
wow.
had a
wow. PhD.
And she was a wife of a Greek Orthodox priest too. But anyway, he said these almonds are these kind of like you see the same thing around Our Lady of Guadalupe in the
Vesica Pisces.
Yeah, that's it, the Vesica Pisces, yeah. And you see that, and they said these were doors that the saints and angels would pass through to heaven, between heaven and earth. So
there may be something. Isn't that the birth canal though? The Vesica Pisces representative
yes, it
of
is.
The woman, right?
That's
so
absolutely the birth canal.
So if the myth is that the angels are coming here through the birth canal, that would be interesting. I think that adds to the idea.
I know that the only one we have that's very popular in the West is the Our Lady of Guadalupe. It's kind of, she's coming through a golden gate that is shaped like the Vesica Pisces.
Yes.
And
I think the ideas are intertwined, and I think that there's more than, like, I just think that there's more information there, that it doesn't simplify to one concept. I just want to address one thing that J.S. Mario is saying in the comments about Enoch left a snowy place.
Yes.
There's a book called Uriel's Machine. It's a fascinating book, and it talks about Enoch taking his wisdom, his information up to Scotland. And it's funny because today Jed mentioned, I think it's called Scarabray, and in Uriel's Machine, this is what is discussed, this idea that some of the information that was held in Egypt and in the Middle East was brought up to the Celtic Islands and Scotland in particular, and that was used as a university to kind of teach these types of things that we're talking about. So I think it ties in really well with J.S. Mario saying he left via a snowy place, and everyone thinks that means he went south, but Antarctica from the Middle East would be so far for people that didn't really have traveling tech. So I don't know, I'm just putting that out there.
Well, I did a video on the Land of Enoch, and it was based kind of on that map that Martin and Nathan went to see in the College of Cambridge, where it had like was it Cambridge or was it Oxford? Anyway, they had an old map and they showed the Land of Enoch in a certain place, and I triangulated it out, assuming that they followed a flat earth organization of the land masses. And I the place where it would be is in the South Indian Ocean. And so I looked in the South Indian Ocean, there's no big land mass there. But I found these two islands, Kerguelen, and what was the other one? Anyway, Heard Island and Kerguelen, the Kerguelen Islands. And I looked them up online to find out what they were about, you know, just to see what their country was like. And apparently they were the last of a submerged subcontinent. And when you pull it up on Google Earth, it's the water is very shallow there, and you can actually see the shape of this ancient land.
They were the last of a submerged subcontinent. And when you pull it up on Google Earth,
whoa.
What happened?
I don't know. We're getting a huge echo for some reason there for a second.
Is it still there now?
Yeah. But anyway. No, I don't hear it.
No, it's all better.
But anyway, I talked about that in the Land of Enoch.
Yeah, I remember that, Robin, actually. And yes, it was very persuasive what you were able to come up with.
Now, it doesn't mean that there weren't angels visiting Scotland, because there was a connection between Egypt and Scotland, because where Scotland, being of Scottish roots, I followed this. So anyway, and Jed was talking about this, they go, yes, that is absolutely right, because there was a group of Egyptians who went up there, and they made an alliance with, I think they were like Egyptians in exile for some reason. They made an alliance with a group of people, and from their description, they were probably Pictish tribes. And they, the reason Scotland has the name Scotland is because they sealed their alliance by a marriage with this Egyptian princess from Egypt named Sikot, right? And it became Scott and Scotland. So, or that's the way the story goes.
That's what the author who researched Ural's Machine, he came to the same conclusion, that it was an Egyptian woman that was married off into one of the Celtic tribes or one of the Scottish.
Yeah, to seal an alliance.
Yeah.
You know, and so, and apparently that I have some friends who are Coptic, and they're like from that area of Alexandria. They have a very Greek sort of tradition, and that apparently a lot of them were red-haired. So that's where you also find a lot of the red-haired peoples up there. Yes?
Sorry.
Oh.
I was trying to see the chat from my cell phone, which did not work very well. So Cortina, who talks to you on the cell phone, said, sorry, Lisa, I didn't get that. And thank you, Cortina, you did not help me. Bye-bye. Anyway, so what's going on?
Okay, I was just talking about Scotland. There was a... there was a Egyptian connection with Scotland. And
yeah, I've read about that, where they're claiming that the Egyptians actually went there and they built... The stones there? What's that, British? Stonehenge?
What was the astronaut that, this is another one that recently went down to Antarctica about a couple months ago. Buzz Aldrin? Yeah, the astronaut Buzz Aldrin went down there. And he took a picture of something near Princess Elizabeth Station. It's kind of, south and east of.
Sorry, I didn't get that.
What? What's happening?
Okay, I have to turn this off. Hold on. Okay. Bye.
But anyway, so.
Oh, Lord.
So anyway, south and east of Princess Elizabeth Station, and he had sent a tweet or something where he'd taken a picture of these three pyramids. There's apparently actually, and I looked him up on Google Earth. I zoomed in on Princess Elizabeth Station. You can see them. Oh, and they look very much like a row of three pyramids, just like.
Wow.
That's
amazing.
And there are apparently three in the Grand Canyon that look like that, too. It's like there's this pattern of three pyramids in several locations around the world in some level of decay.
But see, this is what concerns me, is that all these pyramids are in, like you say, some levels of decay, that these civilizations, whoever built these, whoever had this grand architectural plan, that they're either gone or they died out. And so to me, that's the message, is that they either left, and why would you leave this place? So I don't know. There, I just have questions about that. Or they were destroyed, which means that you can be that advanced and you can still be conquered by your own problems. And that's mm-hmm. how I kind of see our society, where we have the opportunity to do more than we're doing. And we have everything around us to build our own paradise. And instead, we're very miserable and we make our lives very difficult and we make other people's lives very difficult. To me, that would be the benefit of finding out. I think that the government is always worried that if it comes out that there were previous civilizations here and then they were destroyed, the people will panic because they'll think, oh no, ours will also be destroyed. I think it's the opposite. I think it's this idea that, okay, we actually can't just take it for granted that our civilization will survive, that we'll just keep improving. We actually have to work at it. And that it's not enough to just sit back and expect that things are always going to be like this. And so we just have to try to make money and find love. And that's it. Like, that's just not enough. And that's what I kind of think, that's what attracts me to the Flat Earth community rather than just the Flat Earth belief. It's that we need people to get together and say, challenge, I guess, how things are happening and say, look, you know what? This is not good enough, I guess. That's my view.
Well, that, I like that view. That's a good view. I mean,
thank you.
I heard of something. There was a guy who said that because of the human capacity that we have, our intellectual capacity and everything, that we should be much more technically advanced than we are right now. And it's like people have just given up on research and real research, because we have all of these guys with letters after their name saying, oh no, we're the ones who are the guys that do all the inventing.
Yeah, I mean, they're making all of the CGIs and they're doing enough to keep people in their spell. And the problem is that there's so many people, you know, myself included before Flat Earth, that just are afraid to try to do anything.
But that absolves us of responsibility, though. That suggests that we're somehow the victims of these scientists that are not permitting us to, or society that is not permitting it. I think that's a cop-out. Sorry, ladies and gentlemen, I think that's a cop-out. I think I have within myself the power to do what I should do to make an impact in the world and make the world a better place, and to figure out how to do that, to figure out how to contribute to technological advancement or to philosophical advancement, psychological advancement, doesn't matter. Pick whatever you're good at, whatever you have a natural talent for, and do something with it for the good of others as much as just for yourself. And I think people keep wanting society to make it easy for them. But it's hard to get a PhD. You don't need a PhD. You just need to start doing what you're good at and not video gaming, because that's not actually going to make the world a better place. I keep hearing this, especially in the Flat Earth, where everyone's like, oh, the system is keeping us down. No, the system is not keeping you down. The system is there and it's in place and it's oppressing and it's suppressive. But you can build something that's better. And if you build it well enough, it will replace the system. And if you can build it with other people, then it's easier to get the idea to others. But you don't have to have other people around you. You can do it in your own life. And I think, to me, that's the goal, is to say, it's instead of worrying about tearing down the existing system that's keeping you down, how about focus on building something yourself with your skills and talents, and don't worry about the system that's trying to stop you. Just do your own thing and make it so incredible that other people are going to want to do the same thing, to come along, to help and support you. That's how we make a better world. You can't tear down what's there and have everyone living through the dark ages. You have to just build something better and it'll eventually replace. Oh my God, I'm ranting. I'm so sorry.
Oh, no, that's okay. No, I agree with you. And I think that the thing is that you're preaching a little bit to the choir, because we're with you, girl. You know what I'm saying? I mean,
yeah,
we are with you. That's why we're here. That's why we've given up our anonymity to a certain extent, to get out into the public and say, hey, I'm a flat earth and I don't give a damn. And that's my message for anybody today. Sorry, I had my drinks, you know.
Thanks it's interesting to you and go with it. It's like me, electromagnetic waves and things like that. I think there's a source of free energy there, you know? So, I mean, just do what you can to do good. And see, the thing is, for a while there, I was kind of getting sucked into this, oh, we're all victims, we're all just being oppressed, you know? And then one day I said, no, no more, no more. I am not a victim. I am not going to think like a victim. I'm not going to act like a victim. I'm not going to speak like a victim. I am going to be a winner.
I like that. But guess what? There really are victims out there. And it's sad. And right now, this year, we have seen the most horrendous situation with the Pizzagate, which now they're trying to change around and make it look like we're making up. We're making it up. We're making up the fake news and all this stuff. And so there are a lot of people out there that are so taken over by this mind manipulation they can't even hear reality.
I've looked at this, and I know it's easy to get upset about it, but I just look at it and say, you know what this is? This is the death throes of a broken system.
Yeah, it is.
Because there's no way that they can continue this level of evil and remain in any way constructive or stable, you know, because if you got all these people doing evil stuff, that whatever they're doing is going to fall to pieces. Because
that's true.
Evil cannot construct, evil cannot create, evil cannot sustain. It just breaks everything apart. That's all.
Yeah, it's fallen. I mean, it's fallen apart, and this is biblical, and this is all different kinds of things. This is prophesized.
That gives us more of a role, because I think, so all these people that are being damaged by the abuse, by whatever is in place, you mentioned the Pizzagate and all these, the victims. I think that in a way, some people, when they're damaged, it just makes them want to fight harder to make things better. And it creates individuals who have a strong sense of morality because they've endured such an injustice. Mm-hmm. And so I think that for people who don't know how to bring about a better world, well, one way would be to support these people, these victims, so that they don't break entirely, so that yes, they're damaged and maybe nearly broken, but with support and help, they can kind of recover enough. They'll never be whole, but they can probably recover enough to fight against what victimized them in the first place. Yeah. And so I think that's, to me, that's the message of Pizzagate, is not to say all these people are being tortured, isn't it horrible, or this will cause the downfall. It may or may not. I'm more concerned with, what are we doing about this? What are we doing about the victims? It's one thing to try to stop the perpetrators, but as an individual, I have very limited power in doing that. And even working together, the three of us, we have some power, but very little. But there are things that we can do. That's what I'm trying to focus on for the coming year, is figuring out, what can I do in the limited scope that I have, but to the best of my ability, to not just be a watcher of life and not just hoping things will get better. I want to actively start trying harder to make things better, even when it's hard, you know? And that's part of why we need that community to encourage us when we have those hard days where we feel like this is useless and it doesn't matter what I do, the world isn't getting better. That's when you need that community that says, no, you're actually making a difference, right?
Yeah,
that does help. I think one of the things that I made a resolution already is a couple months ago, but realize that things will change if we change our attitude. And, you know, sure, maybe I have been a victim, right? And I probably have, right? You know, there's a lot of injustice in the workplace against women. But I just said, you know what? I'm not even going to focus on that. I am going to focus on being a winner and not being a victim. Even if I am a victim, I'm not going to act like one. I'm not going to do like one. I'm not going to speak like one. I'm going to be a winner.
And, yeah.
And the thing that I discovered, And all I can say is it really worked. It didn't have to be like a big act or something. It was just a change in my mind. And it has to do with this idea that if you change your attitude, you change your life.
Yeah, you know, I think so.
I don't know any way else to describe it except that. No.
We should all go to the Tony Robbins retreat.
Unfortunately,
Tony Robbins is a Luciferian, so I'm not going to do that.
Oh, really?
he's a little over the top for me. I think he address the underlying issues with people that you
Wait,
do.
We never found out what Sasha is. She might be a Luciferian, and if you are, that's okay, because Robin is a past Luciferian. Don't tell anybody. No, we talked about that. Her family is Luciferian.
My family was very involved in Luciferianism, and people do not understand. They are not like the Pizzagate people. They look down on the Pizzagate people because the whole Luciferian thing is self-discipline, self-rule, and then ultimately you will govern everyone else.
And that's where I have the problem with it. Is
I know, but it's always about everybody else, and you're never going to be able to govern everybody else. That doesn't make any sense.
And also, to have that as your end goal, that's a ridiculous end goal. Even just to control people, like even just to acquire more power, because you can never have all the power. Logistically. And you'll never have enough power, because power isn't something that you have forever and ever. You're always going to be challenged in different situations, right? And so you can sacrifice as many children to your God as you want to, but you're always going to have some moments where you're with a woman and you can't get it up. Where's your power there? It's all gone. Or
no, but then that's what they say, Sasha. No, then they say, but I'll just get me a little child and I'll drink its blood and I'll eat me the meat and I'll have a boner.
Yeah. No, that's
more the money and power than sexual power. But
that's so disgusting.
Yeah, there's the thing is with that's a Satanist who do that.
Yeah,
that's silly. That's nonsense. I'm gonna say.
But the Luciferian, the idea that knowledge is power is true. But I don't know. To me, I'm not Luciferian. I think that knowledge is something. Information knowledge is more than most people think it is, and I do see it as a goal of mine to acquire more knowledge about the world. But I think that where I disagree so strongly with Luciferians is that I actually believe in the sanctity of human life.
Hello. Yes.
And in the sacredness of it, and that you can't use other people, even if other people are lower than you, lesser than you, you can't use them for your own ends, because I think that invalidates your own worth and your own...
Yeah, exactly. It like cancels everything out, right?
Yeah, it makes it that you misunderstood the message. And so
you did not get the message. That's what I said to Robin. Robin, I said, if I told you that I have the secret for looking young, for all the rest of your life, you looked immediately 20 years younger. All this, that, and everything else will go back to what was. But the only thing is, you have to eat shit. You have to kill little babies and eat their bodies. You have to take little children and torture them. And then, would you do it? Nobody would. Come on. Some people are doing.
I gave the secret to eternal youth on my YouTube channel, and people thought I was joking, but I was actually completely serious.
Was that you?
What was it?
It was very well researched video. People think, and it wasn't just research, it was actually knowledge, but people just thought it was funny, which is good, because I try to keep my video is funny, because I think if you're giving out information seriously, if you're giving out information that's too true or too challenging, you'll get shut down, you'll get pushed out of the way. And so I feel like some of the things that I have and want to share are sensitive information. And I feel like the only way to be able to get my voice heard is to categorize it as comedy, to put a bit of a satirical spin on it, to make it fun and funny. The message still comes across. And even for people who are listening, when you hear something that when someone like, and this is something I need to learn because I'm always lecturing, when you're lectured at, you're more analyzing the information that someone's trying to push onto you. But yeah. When you're listening to something that's funny, you're a little bit more open. And so you kind of, you'll let it in a little bit more to think about later. And so I think that's part of why I take the approach that I've taken with my channel.
And I've always appreciated it. Go ahead. I keep jumping in. Go ahead, Robin. You tell her.
I just want to know what your secret is because I wonder if it's the same as mine. Because I'm actually 61 years old.
You look so young. The secret is, it like, for women, for men, they just don't have the equipment and their bodies work differently. But for women, it is. It's actually the proteins and components in... It's also found in blood, but it's found in all bodily fluids. So if a woman has younger lovers, there is an anti-aging effect from that.
I heard that. I didn't know if it was only from you or I heard it from somebody. They said that if a woman has a younger man, it's okay, but it doesn't make any difference for men and having younger women. And all
that's correct, because the women's, like in my video, I had used the antidepressant effect of cum as an example, that women have receptors in their
privates.
Yes, their lady bits.
I was going to say nether regions, but I don't.
Yes. That allows for absorption. So it allows for the absorption and it allows for the reception, like their little receptors for those chemicals and hormones. And so they absorb things that are in what men have to offer. Whereas men have none of those receptors or absorbing abilities in any of their places. So for men, they can't use that route. You can... intravenously, you can connect yourself up to the arteries of a younger person, and that you will have some anti-aging effects. But it's not the same because you have problems with blood rejection, you have problems with illnesses, things like that, that are passed through blood. Whereas with sex, a lot of those things are kind of filtered out by the male's body before he does his thing.
Yours is very different than mine.
Okay, what's yours?
That there, most people don't realize the cosmetic value of a clean conscience. It's true.
I have a clean conscience, so I think there's some benefit to it. I do have a very clean conscience because I've been married for 20 some years. Yes, I'm faithful. Yeah, so I could use a little bit of getting younger tonight. Getting a little younger.
Well, as a Catholic, I have at my hand a thing that is available to all Catholics, which is the act of confession, you know, to a priest, the sacrament of confession. And so you go in there, you confess your sins, and there is a supernatural component to it. Most people don't recognize that, but there is a supernatural component to it, and it keeps you young.
I like that. I can see Orphan Rod going to a priest. I can see that. That'd be cute.
I did grow up Catholic. I grew up Roman Catholic, so I did.
I even went back and became a returning Catholic a few years ago. And
it's just that a lot of people don't understand confession, and
even
psychiatrists will say there is even a psychiatric component to, you know, getting.
I can see that. Anytime you say you tell something to somebody else that's important to you. Well, I don't want to say anytime, because you can have some people that are in therapy and they tell too much and they regret that they ever did. But I think if you do it and it's constructive and everything, I mean, that's one of the best things you can do, is to get things off your chest and ask for forgiveness, even if it's from a priest, even if you don't have to believe that he's in place of God. Doesn't matter to me. Is you just doing it, the act of trusting somebody enough to tell some of your secrets to, is a good thing. And we need to get rid of the secrets. That's what kills you.
Well, and again, think about how much stress ages you, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And it tears down all the body chemicals, get all out of balance. But in the act of confession, you release all that stress, even only that. But there is definitely a supernatural component that kind of really makes that act of confession much more powerful. So.
Yeah, I can see that as being a magical, mystical. And that's what I like about you, Sasha, so much, is that you're in touch with your, you know, inner child and your femininity at the same time. You're smart. I think you're just really cute and funny. And so is Robin, because I said, Robin, you know about Sasha? And she said, yeah, I know her. She's nice. She's fun. She's great. She's this. And I'm like, well, we're, you know, I never had any problem with you. And it really hurt me that people would have to say things that weren't nice, because I never saw that in you. I never saw anything that you could say to you. That doesn't make sense. Is that right? Yeah. You know what I'm saying? That meant anything. I mean, it's just mean-spiritedness.
It's just wrong, because I think a lot of it is too, because Sasha, you are a self-possessed, strong personality, and they can't get to you, you know, and so it drives them crazy.
And I like that. Yeah, I like a strong woman. Don't mess with Sasha. Any of you people here in the chat or whatever?
Oh, we already have someone here trying to put me down for having mentioned what I did about the thing. But I mean, this is the thing about me, is that I'm not a very censored person. I don't really filter things out, and I just try to be genuine. And so I don't know.
I think it's ridiculous. I think they just are so, when they see your breast, I think that it's too much for them, and they just freak out, and it just brings up stuff in them that they get angry. I don't know. And then they start taking it out on you, which is silly. Don't watch.
Some people have this thing where they kind of think that if you have larger chest, you must therefore have a lower IQ. And so if in any moment they feel that maybe you're slightly smarter than they are, but you also have a large chest, then they feel like, oh no, that means that this ditz is smarter than I am. Well, we can't have that. And I think that's kind of like this Brian guy in the comments who's, you know, I think that's, or was it Brian? I don't know who it was. No, Mario. I think that's part of that aggression. It's this idea that how dare I show myself to maybe be smarter than he is, because I have big breasts. I'm not allowed to be smarter. I have to be dumb. So I think part of it is that.
Actual stuff. There's no correlation.
There's really none.
I mean, now do you hate me because I show my breasts? I mean, okay, I'm not actually showing them, but I'm just saying. I know what it's like to have big breasts, because I've had it all my life too. And although I never thought anybody thought I was stupid, I never had that.
But even sexuality, like I see comments here, like Brian making a comment that's sexually explicit. I think that's a part of it as well, is that to me, I'm very comfortable talking about sexuality in a non-sleazy way. I don't see it as something perverted and sleazy. And I don't talk about it as something sleazy. I'm very matter of fact about it, because that's what I think it is. And they need to turn it into something perverted, because they think sexuality has to be perverted.
I hear you.
I also noticed that his comment addressed sexuality in a way that was, oh, sorry. Did the sun go out?
No, you're all good.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I can't hear Orphan Red.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can. Good. Okay, but I think the reason, the thing is, the go-to with these guys is in the, you know, when they try to make a snide comment, is it's always some form of unnatural sex. Because it's like, if they had natural sex, it would cause some kind of emotional response to them, which they don't want that. They just want the unnatural response.
I agree. Yeah, I think you're right about that. And I just think it's, to me, I don't, I don't see it as insulting. I see it as so sad. I think it's so sad that so many men and women have been given this idea that sex is only this perverted, sleazy thing that only perverted, sleazy people talk about. And I'm like, no, that, like, you're missing out on so much of the experience of being a human being, of sacredness, of sanctity, of intimacy, and of fun and pleasure. And being an adult, I think that they're missing out on all that because for whatever reason, they've been stuck in this 13-year-old attitude towards sex being kind of confusing and kind of shameful. And so when they make those comments, it doesn't even hurt my feelings. It just makes me feel so sad that there's so many people like them that
it's kind of pathetic. And they're usually people who, like, you know, watch porn. So
did you notice I'm wearing my Porn Kills Love t-shirt? No, I'm really supporting this movement.
It actually does. I mean, if some guy like this Brian guy talked to me, he'd give me about 2 seconds of my attention and I'd just tell him to hit the road because he's not at all appealing to any woman when he, like, you know, I mean, like, you know, go away.
Well, and Sasha, aren't you in school for to be a sex something or?
Yeah, I'm working on becoming a sex therapist. Well, intimacy counselor, couples and intimacy counseling. Yeah.
Okay, so there you go. I mean, if they only took the time to really get to know who you are.
But it shouldn't matter. It shouldn't matter. I should be able to be a woman that is as I am and talks as I do. I don't have to somehow legitimize it by saying, oh, I'm allowed to have a healthy attitude towards sex because I'm educated about it. No.
Yeah.
The thing is when they talk like this, that you know they're just turning you into an object. They don't see you as a human being anymore. And
that
so,
reminds me of Antonio, doesn't it? You objectify me. You objectify me. Oh, look, and here's my skirt, you guys. Oh, my tree. Oh, gosh. Here's my skirt.
It's a very nice skirt. It's really nice plaid.
It's my Disney. It's from Disneyland.
Nice. I like it.
Thank you. I got a Disneyland for Christmas. Yeah.
It's super cute.
My tree fell.
Oh no.
Oh, Brian's saying that all his perverse stuff is like it would give you such pleasure. Right. Yeah.
But see, that's the thing. Like, that's what I don't understand is again this idea that you can't have a healthy perspective of sexuality and still be explorative or exciting or that, do you know what I mean? Like, they're not mutually exclusive. A lot of it though is how you understand it to be and the meaning that you attach to it. So two people can do the same thing, but if one of them thinks that it's this perverted, sleazy, shameful thing that they're doing and the other person just thinks that this is just an enjoyment of human sexuality, those acts are actually different, even though they're physically doing the same thing, in my opinion. I was going to go off tangent, but I won't because I'll save it for something else.
Save it for you next time you come on. If you want to.
I will.
But, I think this is, his response is typical of somebody who is basically a porn addict. Because what they see in a porn video is normal sexuality. It's not. The women in there are not having fun. A lot of time they get injured. Most porn stars die very young. So these women he's slobbering over may be in a coffin somewhere. You know, removes a lot of your humanity from you. And just the way he's talking, and I can obviously problem with porn. Because he said, oh, well, that's the way it's normally, all of this, you know, objectifying of people.
But that's why I think it's so sad. Because, and I actually think that if we're going to talk about Luciferians manipulating society, I think that one of the most powerful things that has been done to us is they've destroyed sexuality in its most powerful form, and they've created something to replace it, and it destroys intimacy, it destroys bonding, and we don't even have the tools to talk about real sex anymore. And that's, I think that's something that I would like to see change.
Yeah, because
I'm starting two new channels in 2017. I'm going to do a channel that's more Sasha and more against scientism. And I'm doing another channel that's going to be more fun. I want to start exploring more of these topics. That's one of the things I've gained from being part of the Flat Earth in 2016, is more of an awareness of what I see in society that I disagree with or that I think is going wrong, and more of this idea that I myself can make different choices to live differently and to try to impact society. What do you guys think? Robin, do you?
I think that's great. I think one of the things I would like to see more discussion of is this idea that how we dehumanize each other and how we no longer relate to each other like human beings and interact as human beings. It's always like, you know, a few words on Twitter or, you know, I mean, social media is kind of having a bad impact in some ways because we don't see each other as real anymore. I mean, I know you as real because I've met you personally. But, you know, if we don't find a way to, you know, I mean, it's like the troll effect where people just throw some snotty stuff out there and disappear.
Yeah, that's just wrong.
You know, and there's a lot of it on the internet today, the troll effect. And where they just no longer see the people that they're interacting with as human beings, and they just act like a jerk. And also, you know, so many people are retreating into like video games and porn, you know, and so they no longer see the rest of the world as human beings. I mean, they can sit on a video game and kill 100 people and, you know, and then get 5 lives. They get killed, they get resurrected, and it's like life is no longer real to them. You know.
Yeah.
Sorry about that. That's kind of a rant I have, that people are not interacting as humans anymore.
Well, I think that's true.
I think that's wonderful that we are interacting. This is a true interaction. And this is okay for now. You know, sure, I'd love it if you guys lived right around the corner from me. I come over every day. I love being in your company. And I love clever people too, most of them. They just feel like Daniel Pratt seems like a cousin of mine.
Yeah,
and what's that guy, Joey? Not just Star Gods. Like, I feel like I could just walk over down the street and go over his house and hang out for a while because he's funny to me. And I know some people don't like him, but I do. And I like most of my flat earthers really, really a lot. Thank you all you flat earthers out there for just being there for me. I really mean that.
Yeah, and I think that's what we need is more people that are behaving like real human beings. Because a lot of people come in here into the hangouts and the internet and all that and chat room, and they're basically there to be gratified in some way. They just want to be gratified. They don't. The people out there that they're interacting with are not really people. They're just words on a page, and they don't see themselves as. It's like they're just all wrapped up in themselves. It's not really being selfish. It's more self-absorbed.
But it's not seeing other people as ends in themselves, as everyone is a means to an end, to my end. It's that Luciferian kind of perspective. Exactly. Like we have Brian here saying, oh, I've trolled, made people laugh, no one's hurt. And so it's like, okay, so you're going to use other people, put them down, hurt feelings that you don't know you've hurt, so that you can feel like you're funny. People are paying attention to you. So it's all about what you're getting out of that interaction. And it's the same with Tim Osman, who pretends that he really just wants to educate flat earthers to save them from the deception. But it's not, because he's not doing what one would do if you wanted to save people from a cult. What he's doing is self-aggrandizement. He feels like he's smarter, he's better, he has to help these poor idiots. That's not actually about helping other people. That's about making himself feel important, better, powerful. And so again, it's always this idea of you're not, like Robin is saying, you're not treating other people as sacred human beings who are, I don't know, who are equal in terms of their value.
Like he said, he's made other people laugh. Well, yeah, he makes the other trolls laugh, but he hurts a lot of people in the process. And I mean, do you wake up every morning? Because this is what I do. I wake up in the morning and I say, I am determined to do as much good as possible and cause as little misery as possible to the people around me. Because we don't need to add to the misery of the world. There's plenty of it out there already. And yeah. I don't know, it just really annoys me because these people think they're extra special good, right?
That they're doing all the,
and they don't even come out from behind your computer screen and interact with real people.
And I want to say something to Brian because he's like, oh, I'm putting a smile on your face. You're not. And it's not that you're hurting my feelings. It's that when I see people behave like this, it reminds me of how many messed up people there are, of how many bad people, of how many lost people, of how many people there are who are working against me. I'm here trying to make the world a better place, and you are making my mission harder because not only are you making the world uglier, but you're dragging other people into that culture of ugliness. So my job is harder because of people like you.
Agreed.
And I'm not here to save you. I'm here to save the people that want something better, that don't want to live in this ugly, horrible place. And so that's why it upsets me. It's not because it hurts my feelings when someone makes sexually derogatory comments about me. It's just because of what it represents. That's why it's upsetting.
And I agree with you. And when I think about this year, and I think about the most upsetting time in my life, it was Nathan and Antonio, and we're talking about that Luciferian spirit, is that what really upset me is I saw Nathan and Antonio, and then Nathan continuous, even as of last week, on another one of Antonio's little get-together. They're always keep trying to say, why? They keep asking the same question to people. Why do you believe God helped you when you could have just helped yourself? You just helped yourself. It had nothing to do with anything else, magical, no God, no nothing. It's just you helped yourself. Why don't you want to take credit for that? Why don't you take umbrage? Want to take credit for that? Because I don't need to take credit for that. Yeah, I don't have any problem with giving it to God as the person that I prayed to and he helped me. What's wrong with that?
Yeah,
I don't have to.
I just marked our friend Brian here. I know what he's about. He's one, because now he switched to, oh, it's you guys who are picking on me.
Shut up.
Yeah. So what I'm thinking is he might be one of these special snowflakes from millennials, because their typical thing is they go out and they behave like obnoxious jerks to everyone, and then they come back in and they say, oh, you're picking on us. You're the ones causing all the trouble. Well, you know?
Bah, yeah, just, you.
Yeah, I mean, can you just go out there and not make everybody miserable? What kind of existence is that to know that?
I know. Nobody likes this guy's name Brian.
Yeah, nobody likes you, and you're making everybody around you miserable, and thus you end up more and more lonely.
Yeah. You know? So let's not let him derail us anymore.
Let's just get him out.
You don't even have to.
You're the one who has to do it.
Talk about what we want to talk about. We're not going to be dictated to by someone in chat.
Don't like it, and I don't like it, Brian. You're on my show, starting crap on my show. It's Christmas time, damn it.
We're going to boot them out. We're going to the ranch and I'll boot him out.
It's Christmas.
Yeah, these people wouldn't say this stuff if we were in the room, would they? Because I would jump over this desk. I swear, I wish they were closer.
No. Oh, believe me, I'm ex-military. I could take him out first.
I know. Watch out. If I'm not good enough, I'll be back there. I got my back.
No, I was. They would leave me.
And Robin has had my back. Speaking of having my back, she came to my emotional rescue right after our Nathan and Antonio kill God week and a half of ridiculousness. Robin called me. I was trying to just talk to anybody because there's no flat earth people to talk to. At that point, I didn't even have a show. I just came out. I think it was Antonio's show. It was my first time. It was just my voice. So I really didn't, at that time, I didn't have a place like I have now to say something about it. But now I do. And here I am, people. So bring it on.
And there can there can be creation without destruction. You don't need to build things from the chaos. Order out of chaos? No. And you don't have to build things from the ruins. You can take what you have, you can take what's there, and you can improve it and shape it into something better. Yeah. I think that's the focus for me anyway.
I like that focus. Me too.
Nothing sells like No, it was MacArthur. He sells nothing sells like victory.
Yeah, there's no best revenge than success.
Yeah, exactly. And it just creates something new, makes something better. It's like with me, I fiddle around with free energy systems. You know, people are having a lot of trouble. And I'll tell you, I don't want to make any money off of it. I'm too much like Tesla, I guess. But I would just like to figure it out. Because I think I'm still working on it. But I'm finding out that I think this could be built with a minimal amount of parts, like stuff you get at Home Depot or something, you know, and you could build it yourself. And when I figure out the design for it, I'm just going to send it to everybody. So I'll send it to you and you send it to everyone you can find. And that way they won't be able to bottle it into a patent or.
Yeah, I'll do that. I'll definitely do that.
That's the only way it'll get out.
Because if you try to get a patent on it, it'll be just like all these other guys that have created free energy systems. Some big oil company comes in, buys out the patent, and buries it. So the only way you can get it out is to give it to everyone. Just send it to everyone on your mailing list. Everyone on your, you know, send it. Tell them to send it to everyone on their mailing list. Just
that's cool. I love that.
A viral trend.
Guess what?
What?
What? It is almost end of our show, and I'm sad because I really enjoy having both you ladies here with me. How exciting!
It was fun, unexpected. We kind of covered all kinds. I thought we were just going to talk about Christmas, Flat Earth Christmas. It was awesome.
It was so great to have you on, Orphan Red.
Orphan Red, you got to come back more anytime you want. You have all you have to do. Is if you see we have a show and you go, oh, I'd like to talk to them, just, you know, put something in the chat, say it's Orphan Red, I'm here, and Robin will send you the information. You just come on. I mean that for life. You come anytime. You can come every single Saturday night if you want, seriously. I like having you around.
You can say anything you want.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate that. I really appreciate it. I've had a harder time finding support among some of the women in the flat earth, and so it feels that much more special to know that. Aww. Yeah, it's really nice, so thank you. I appreciate
it. Oh, you're very welcome. You know what, you are welcome here. We love Orphan Red for her spirit,
and Robin is always, you've always been a great supporter, and I really appreciate that. And I think Robin, you're one of the most underappreciated contributors to Flat Earth. And I don't know why. Like, I think you are such a resource for our community. And I'm looking forward to the time when people start waking up and realizing that, because you have more to offer than people understand.
I figured it out fast. I'm like, I'm getting this girl on my side right now. Come on, do the show.
I am trying to work on some new research. Like I say, free energy, that's a little more down the road. But I think because of the way the magnetic fields in the world work, based on if it's a dome, it should work. If it's a flat plane, I'm not sure if it would work. But the dome will definitely work. Although flat plane would make it more like a capacitor than an inductor. But, electrical engineering.
She's going off into our science.
I do think I am trying to work on some new things. I want to go through the whole curvature, because people are questioning that. And I do want to do a presentation on the nature of the magnetic field on the Earth, because I'm having a real problem with Globusters. No offense, but they're
you're better than that. It's okay.
Yeah, their view of the map is wrong.
You know what, Robin? I would like to talk to you about this further. I'm interested in what you have to say about the magnetic fields and their map and the three poles. So you and I should get together and talk about that at some point.
I'm not really fond of that one, because I said there's too many things that don't work about it from a geometric standpoint. Just plain Euclidean geometry, it doesn't work. Okay. Sorry,
It is an interesting field. And are you doing work with like ley lines and magnetic fields?
No, I'm looking at the very nature of if the dome is what I think it is, and I've talked about that on some of my videos, and just the idea that actually in ancient books I've looked at stuff, because I can read Latin, and and I found, because there's a lot of stuff that actually people find in ancient writings that give an idea of how it might work in real life.
Yeah,
because science has buried so much of our knowledge from the medieval times, ancient times. There was a lot of knowledge just being hidden from us.
Oh, lots.
Because there's no emphasis in education on history, and specifically history of Western culture, and also specifically about the education systems of the Middle Ages and stuff like that, and the writings in the Middle Ages. So
yeah, they can't let that out, because it'll explain all the stuff that they took out of history.
Yeah, it's like they make fun of St. Thomas Aquinas because he said, well, the earth is under a dome and it's like this and it's flat and all this. And so they say, well, he was not a very good scientist because he thinks the earth is flat and it's under a dome and it's got seven layers and all this. And, you know, and so they just think he's an idiot. But you start reading into his works, it's like five volumes of stuff, but there's interesting stuff out there. I'm sorry.
Like the Vedic, like Santos Bonacci and the Vedic way of looking at the dome, and like you were saying, there's layers.
Yeah.
I believe there's layers, because I told you, if anybody wants to look at my, if anybody wants to look at my, I had a demon thing happen, if you want to call it a demon, but, it was in my Halloween show when I said that I had something happen where some kind of spirit came in my room and basically pushed my body down, like all these layers. All I can remember is being pushed down layers. So when I hear the layering, it makes sense to me, because I had an experience of being pushed down way, way down, and it was this layer type of feeling.
Yeah. And remember, St. Thomas Aquinas was also speaking from a spiritual level as well. So since he was a monk in a monastery and studying theology as well. So. But, I have to say, Sasha, I'm so glad you're on, because I'm always wiggling around in my chair. I can't sit still. You're the same way, so it doesn't look so weird.
I am.
I don't like to sit still either.
I try to stay still so my face doesn't look like it's going all around. But
I forget that.
Oh, it's good.
Just gotta be yourself.
This was really good. Thank you so much for inviting me, Lisa. And Robin, we'll talk off air sometime this week, hopefully, because I want to know more. And I think there are a lot of correspondences between us that I appreciate.
Yeah, exactly. And, I still got my Flat Earth book here. And I've been making notes of it. Every now and then I get an idea and I write it down. I think the last one was kind of weird, because what I was doing was going back over the curvature, because people keep denying that it's really 8 inches per mile squared. So I redid it again. And based on, and I also redid the distance to the sun based on Eratosthenes' measurements on a flat earth instead of a sphere. And I still get 3,655 miles. So.
Yeah,
that makes sense. Closer the better, because it is not any 93 billion, and we know that.
We all know that.
it's just ridiculous. And you've got 90, how could we even see 93 billion miles away? I don't care how big the sun was. That doesn't even make sense.
Yeah, it's nonsense. I never kind of.
It doesn't even make sense to me from the beginning. So I don't even have to, I don't feel pressured to do anything anymore as far as trying to prove it, you know, mathematically or anything like that. They can't prove that the Earth is here and round mathematically. They can't prove that. They can't take a picture. They can't do anything. So I'm just, I just go from, because I'm an Aquarius and I just believe what's in my heart.
Oh, hey, Potty Mouth. One more thing. Potty Mouth Brian just said that he wanted Orphan to, Red to email him.
Yeah, that's not going to happen.
What's going to happen? What did he say?
He wanted to talk to her by email, so.
No.
Oh, hell no. Hell no, Brian. No.
I just, it's not even a mean thing. I have limited time, and I'm not going to waste my time with people who I don't genuinely believe are here to help.
I know. And he's what, 12, if 18? I can tell by the way he's talking. He's probably like 19 or 20 or something. And he's probably like, I'm your younger man. No, not. Not really, Brian. Not. We look for a little bit more than that, okay?
I just think, you know, I need people who inspire me and motivate me in order to stay inspired and motivated. And I can't lend my time to people who are fighting that and looking to uninspire people just because they're bored and they want entertainment. I just don't have time for that.
Good. I don't either. Who does? We're too smart for that now. Maybe in my past, but no more. If you're not making me, because I love making people feel good, and I can tell that about Sasha, and I can tell that too about you, Robin, that we're people pleasing people. Now, we want to help people.
I'm like Joel Osteen. I'm an encourager.
Exactly. Like me too. I'm like, I'm always going to tell you look pretty. Even when you may not, or, you know, I tell people I don't even know stuff. I tell people, like, I'll be standing next to somebody and if I like their hair or something, I'll just tell them, and they're like, thank you. You made me feel so good. No, my relatives don't even say things like that to me, and I'm like, that's sad. Because you really look pretty today, you know?
It's like, for me, it's like, I just want to say to everyone in the world, you can do it. You have it inside of you. You can do it. Just let it out, and your ability to succeed is in you. You have everything you need to be a success, and you can do it. So don't get discouraged. Just keep pressing. Go, go, go.
Yes. That's Brian. You can do it. You cannot be a troll. You can be nice.
You can be a real person.
Hurt people's feelings. You don't have to make them feel like they're stupid. You don't. So for 2017, I want you to start to not be a stupid troll. Be smart. Yeah,
I just think he can learn to actually interact with girls in a way that they would
be a better way. Yeah, better interaction.
I'm not talking about porn girls. I'm talking about real girls. And you could learn to interact with them in a way that they might actually like you to some degree.
And I would like to thank the gentlemen in our chat who were lovely, and
really?
we had some really good people in chat today.
Who was in chat? Who was in chat?
There's a whole bunch of good people, and I just want to say thank you, you guys.
I kept in chat, guys.
Well, Synthetic Dread was here, being very good, and really good guy.
I want to cuddle with him. I'm married. Oh,
and we had J Dreamers. Z. I always in
Dreamer.
We say Zed, so it's always a bit weird. J Dreamer Z.
Hi, J Dreamers. Who else is in there, or was?
Who else has been here?
I wasn't watching it very well. I'm sorry.
That's okay. I know there. I missed a whole nother world. All these shows.
One of these days, we'll have to sit down and teach you how to use it.
I know. Well, we have to have another thing that Mark Sargent had. We have to tell him that, and I'll come up there.
A mixer.
Yeah, I'll come to Washington and stay at Robin. She told me I could stay there.
If I hadn't been feeling so crappy last week, I was thinking about getting together something for New Year's Eve, a flat New Year's Eve.
No, yeah, we have to think.
I was going to go back to San Francisco for the holidays, but I didn't end up going. I kind of wish I had. There are a lot of flat earthers down there, and I think
I love going to San Francisco.
Yeah, I think we should do an event there and just figure a way of getting people.
We could do
there.
That. I love going there. I always stay at the Grand Hyatt, and with my son, and we just like to take like a little afternoon. We drive up, and then we get there about 3 o'clock, and then we go to the Grand Hyatt and take a nap. And then we go up to the top, and you can go to a really beautiful restaurant there and look out at, you know, all the beautiful buildings, the big pyramid over, of course, in San Francisco building. And then we do like Chinatown shopping and get like stuff from Chinatown, and then go to the Nike store and stuff. That's boring, but yeah, I'd love to meet you guys in San Francisco. That'd be fun.
Yeah.
That'd be awesome.
I'd be more partial to Vegas, but only because of my math brain, because I like going to the tables.
Also, Vegas is more affordable from different locations, so I also, that would also work.
That's why I always wanted to have the conventions in Vegas, baby Vegas.
What I liked was, I haven't been there for a few good years, but the Paris Hotel there is beautiful.
Oh, nice. Yeah,
it's like you're walking in. They have this thing where you're walking in like a print, what I'm trying to say, it's Parisian village.
Yeah.
And so it feels like it's open air. It really feels like you're walking in its air, but it's not. It's just the way that the environment
they do
is
that,
in it.
They do that in Caesar's Palace. They have like...
Oh, yeah?
The Roman streets of Rome, and you're just wandering around this huge shopping mall.
Yeah, it's so fun, guys.
The streets of Rome, so.
Yeah, huh?
Yeah, like ancient Rome.
I know, I get it. We should do that, girls. Let's do it.
Remember
okay. I don't want to sit here and talk forever. This is our longest show.
Okay, so we should call it. I should go, actually, because I was going to film a video after this. I'm all melted now, though.
Bacon, they call it now. Bacon.
Yeah, that's right.
I love you, Orphan Red. Thank you for coming.
I love you guys.
Bob and Paul, I love you. You're the best friend and co-host ever. Love it.
And you can call me just when you're married.
Merry Christmas, all. Merry Christmas. I love you, my Flat Earth friends. From the bottom of my heart, I love you all. And I'm so grateful that you're all here. The ones that watch, and I appreciate you so much. I hope you all have a happy new year, too. We'll probably have a little happy new year show as well. But until then, bye. We love you.
Bye.
Bonjour.
Bye.
Au revoir.
Merry Christmas.
Au revoir.